This video is brought to you by our tech channel partners, JLCPCB. If you have a PCB board idea that you want to see made a reality, check out our description below. JLCPCB can make it happen. Hey friends, welcome to Flite Test Tech. I'm Josh.
And I'm Tanner.
Tanner's from Tradium here, and he's going to be taking us further down the runway here from PCB board design to now the components that are going to be going into the PCB boards. What do we got here?
Well, the first component to talk about is resistors. Every one of these components is going to come in a bunch of different packages. You start with the larger ones, which is more common in hobbyist type uses, which are the through-hole components. They're larger. You can solder those by hand with a soldering iron. You get all the way down to really small surface mount packages, the 0603 package size and even smaller.
Okay.
Those are put on typically by a pick and place machine, although you can prototype by hand with tweezers and
paste
and whatever else. So a resistor in an electrical circuit is meant to resist electric current flow. And so it's sort of bound by a law called Ohm's law, or voltage equals current times resistance. One way to think about it is it's like a restriction of flow. If you were looking at a pipe, it's like a narrowing in the pipe.
Yeah, you got a garden hose and you pinch it, you're the resistor.
Yep, exactly. The next common component that we'll talk about here is capacitors. So a capacitor resists changes in voltage. There's all kinds of different types, but they all do the same thing. They store a charge in an electric field. The idea is if you have a noisy electrical signal, let's say a voltage that's changing, this will store a charge and let some of that charge out when it gets to a valley in that noise.
Okay.
And it'll take on some charge when it gets to a peak. So you can smooth out a noisy signal with a capacitor.
Now this is very common. If you guys have electronic speed controls or ESCs, you'll oftentimes see a capacitor at the very end of the ESC. And that's exactly for that reason. When you plug it in and when you unplug it and stuff, it kind of takes some of that fluctuations from the battery, correct?
Yeah, that, and it's also there because electric motors are very noisy. So they generate a lot of backwards current that comes actually back out of the motor.
Oh wow.
And that capacitor's there to absorb some of that. That sort of category is what we call passive electronics. That kind of includes resistors, capacitors, and inductors. Then we start talking about the more active components and the semiconductors. So the first one's a diode, and a diode is the simplest semiconductor. And semiconductor is exactly what it sounds. It's a device that conducts sometimes, but not always. So you can think of a diode as a one-way check valve. It allows current to flow through it only in one direction. And if current tries to flow in the other direction, it stops becoming a conductor. Up from there is LEDs. I don't know if you know this, but LED stands for light emitting diode.
Yep.
So it's just a diode that emits light. And it's also a one-way check valve. So that's why you can't make an LED work if you hook it up the wrong way.
And oftentimes when you look at that, there's a one longer stem on an LED that you want to plug down. What is that, the positive or negative?
The longer stem is the positive side. You have to sort of denote which one's the anode and the cathode, but yeah, in that case, you know, that's what you're looking at. On a regular diode, you'll see there's a stripe. That stripe represents the negative side.
Very cool. So when oftentimes when you're soldering and you want current to pass through, are you gonna go from negative to positive or positive to negative?
Yeah. If you put the ground side on the ground side stripe, current will flow.
Okay.
If you put that in the other way around, if you have positive coming into the ground side, then it won't.
Wonderful. So after we move here, and by the way, I mean, these things range in size. I know with your resistors, they get to that size there.
Yeah, so and
these get small too.
Same exact thing. Yep, you get all kinds of different sizes for these parts. You know, if you're building a circuit board where size isn't all that critical, it's a lot easier to put something together with through-hole parts that you can hand solder.
Absolutely.
If you start trying to put these same electronics into something the size of your smartphone or a watch, you have to get a lot smaller parts.
Is it safe to say if you have an idea in your head and you design your board, you can design a board much bigger and more manageable with larger parts, and then once you see that it works, you can convert to just a smaller where it does the same thing but just in smaller size?
That's right? Absolutely true. The other thing is these through-hole parts can be installed in something called a breadboard, which is just it's like a temporary circuit board that you can just push parts in. You don't have to solder. That allows you to prove your concept, make sure your system works, and then once you figure it out and see that it works, you can move to designing a circuit board in CAD.
I think that's gonna be a future video.
We should probably do that.
Well, wonderful. All right, so we got our resistors and we got our diodes. What are these guys?
This is the next most, you're kind of moving up in the direction of semiconductors. These are transistors. And a transistor is basically a switch. It has three leads. One of the leads is referred to as the gate.
Okay.
If there's a current on the gate, then electricity is allowed to flow between the other two leads. There's different types of transistors. There's some that only switch very small loads. Then there's some larger ones like MOSFETs that can switch larger loads. That they all basically do the same thing. They allow electricity to flow through when there's a signal on the gate.
And generally, is the gate the middle wire? Or?
It varies across all of them. So it's always, if you take like the part number on this and you were to punch it into Google and get the data sheet,
okay. You'd
be able to see what the pinouts are.
Okay.
But there's no set rule.
And there's no symbols on the actual transistor that shows which
there
one
are not. No.
Okay. So basically, guys, if you need a transistor, make sure that you go to Google to figure out which one is which. Now, I'm guessing, I think I've blown up many transistors in the past. You can pop those if you wire them wrong, right?
Yeah, a lot of these components you can. Even like a diode, putting too much voltage in it the wrong direction,
yeah,
or trying to run too much through it in the wrong way will cause it to break down.
Very good.
And then we'll get to the kind of the most complicated component here, and that's these chips. So chips are semiconductors. They're very complicated semiconductors. They come in every shape and size imaginable. And they start out simple. They can get to a, you know, very, very complicated. Again, this is a part that would have to be, you know, I mean, you could do it for prototyping purposes by hand, but
yeah. It's
much better meant for machine assembly. Like some of these chips, the contacts are underneath them. You can't even see the contacts to solder, so you would never be able to put that on with a soldering iron. Chips, these types of semiconductors are what you get when you take hundreds of thousands, millions, billions, and even trillions of transistors and put them all in the same package. And what you can do with something like that is, you can, if you're a software developer or you know you're playing around with software, you can write a program and install it on that chip and say, you know, at this point in time, I want one of these pins to send a signal out or receive signals in and turn that into understandable data. That's really where you can put real intelligence into your circuit.
So it's just a bunch of basically transistors in here, a bunch of gates that are turning on and off and stuff.
Everything comes down to ones and zeros.
Yeah.
And that's what a transistor does. It's either on or off. So on is one, off is zero. And that's how this all gets translated into digital.
My goodness. And these chips and stuff, you could have these chips programmed and do one function or a completely different one. It could be controlling lights or it could be controlling sound.
Yeah, so and this is where it gets really complicated because different chips are better suited for different tasks.
Okay.
And that's all kind of in the data sheets. You can have a chip that on this board does one thing, and on another board that uses the exact same chip could do a totally different thing. Or even on the same board, just running two different programs.
Very cool. All right, so tell us about the difference between a gyro and accelerometer, because if you guys are in the quad world or even with model airplanes like our FT-405, we have gyros, accelerometers, I think they're six-axis accelerometers. So what's the difference?
Yeah, so an accelerometer measures accelerations.
Okay.
And it measures those in G-forces. So if you were trying to figure out, let's say, how many Gs you're pulling when you do a loop or when you do a tight turn,
okay. You
would measure it with an accelerometer. And you would want to make sure that one of those axes is lined up going straight through the top of the airplane.
All right.
And that way, as you pull through, you're going to see the G-forces on that axis.
Gotcha.
Now, if you wanted to know something like, what's my roll rate? An accelerometer isn't really good at figuring that out. You wouldn't be able to easily calculate your roll rate based on accelerometer data.
Okay.
You'd want a gyroscope. A gyroscope measures your angular velocity.
That's amazing. So basically, in order to get an airplane to level out, you're using gyros and accelerometers together.
You're using them together.
In every axis.
And there's some complicated math that happens in there called fusion algorithms, which are responsible for meshing those two things together.
So obviously all these components work together to give us functionality, but that has to go outside the board now, and that's where the connectors come into play.
Yeah, and there's a big world for connectors. There's all sorts of different kinds. You know, there's a couple here, like this is a USB-C connector,
yep.
You know, just a regular like 2.5 millimeter header.
And speaking of the 2.5 millimeter header, this is probably, not the specific connector, but the pin spacing. That is what is common with our servos, correct?
Yeah, I believe it's 2.54 is the
okay. Actual
measurement pin spacing, and that's called pitch. So that's the distance between two pins on
okay. The
connector. So the pitch is 2.54. That's what's used like on your servo connectors, a lot of times on battery connectors, if it's that's a JST.
JST, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So that's the same pin spacing as that.
Perfect. So the main goal in here with board design is obviously it doesn't just end with the power distribution board like we did in our previous episode. This is where we start developing it, and based on the functionality you guys may want, whether it's LEDs, whether it's a sound card, whether it's something that detects motion, is how you're gonna be using these components on a board.
Yeah, so we're kind of going from the standpoint of designing a power distribution board, which is about as simple as it could get, to how can we start to use some of these Lego blocks that we have here.
That's a great way to say it.
To build something better.
And speaking of Lego blocks, I think our next episode is where we're gonna start kind of exploiting just the properties of this so you guys can see how resistors and transistors come to make a simple function here. And from that point on, you guys will be able to dream a little bigger and design something for yourself. So friends, thanks for being part of the Flite Test family. And Tanner, man, thank you so much for coming back and then sharing a little bit more about PCB board design.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
Tanner's not only a part of the Flite Test community, but also he runs Tritium Studios. You guys do all sorts of amazing services in regards to assembling these, correct?
And yeah, software. So a lot of times, you know, we have our own assembly equipment, but we're, you know, helping customers take their ideas from an idea to a product that can ship.
I love it. And a huge shout out to our Tech Channel sponsor, JLCPCB. They're the reason that we're making these videos here so you guys can be able to take your PCB board designs and make them a reality. So what do you think, next time? Some board design?
Absolutely.
Awesome. Friends, we'll see you next time.